Thou carriest them away as with a flood. They are as sleep. In the morning, they are like grass which groweth up. In the morning it flourisheth and groweth up. In the evening it is cut down and withereth. For we are consumed by thine anger, and by thy wrath are we troubled. Thou hast set our iniquities before thee, our secret sins in the light of thy countenance. For all our days are passed away in thy wrath. We spend our years as a tale that is told. The days of our Lord are 80 years and 10. And if by reason of strength, they be 80 years, yet is there strength, labor, and sorrow. For it is soon cut off, and we fly away. Who knoweth the power of thine anger? Even according to thy fear, so is thy wrath. So teach us. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. So, and amen. It is our honor on today to welcome you to the celebration of life for Queen Mother Ulysses Teresa Charrington. On today, we expect to do 3 things. One is to celebrate, because the Bible tells us that every good and perfect gift comes from above. The next is that we will comfort this family and prepare them for a season of closure. And so whether it be through song, word, scripture read, we ask that you would join in this celebratory service for a life that is well lived. Amen. At this time, we will have a musical selection from Sister Francine Finley.
Of a million angels cannot express my gratitude. Everything I am and ever hope to be, I owe it all to thee. To God.
this time, we will have our scripture reading from Ayana and Stephen Henry of the Old Testament, followed by the New Testament reading from Deaconess Marcella Pasley. Following that, there will be a musical selection from Brother Jackie Finch, in that order.
Good morning, everyone. Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hadst formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Thou turnest man to destruction and sayest, return ye children of men. For 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday when it is past, and as a watch in the night. Thou carriest them away as with a flood. They are as asleep. In the morning they are like grass, which groweth up. In the morning it flourisheth and groweth up. In the evening it is cut down and withereth.
For we are consumed by thine anger, and by thy wrath we are troubled. Thou hast set our iniquities before thee, and our secret sins in the light of thy countenance. For all our days are passed away in thy wrath. We spend our years as tale that is told. The days of our years are 80 years and 10, and if by reason of strength they be 80 years, yet is their strength labor and sorrow, for it is soon cut off and we fly away. Who knoweth the power of thine anger? Even according to thy fear, so is thy wrath. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom.
The New Testament lessons taken from 1 Corinthians 15, reading from verse 50 to 58. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doeth the corruption inherit corruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trump shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, that is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as he know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. This is the blessed word of the Lord.
I've learned how to live holy. I've learned how to live right. See, I've learned how to suffer. For if I suffer, I'll gain eternal life. You see, I've learned how to live holy. I've learned how to live right. You see, I've learned how to suffer. For if I suffer, I'll gain eternal life. But when I see Jesus, amen. When I see Jesus, amen. All my troubles will all, they will be over. When I see Jesus, amen. When I see Jesus, amen. When I see the man who died for me, the man who set me free, amen. All my troubles, all my heartaches, all my disappointments will all be over. When I see Jesus, amen. When I see Jesus, amen. When I see the man who died for me, the man who set me free, they will be over. When I see Jesus,
It was said that in the life of this church, on last night, testimony after testimony came of the places that people found Mother Charrington in this church. Each and every one of them were tied to a moment of prayer. I invite you now to join me in Mother Charrington's favorite position of service to the Lord, and that is in prayer. Father, we thank you on today. We praise you. We adore you. We love you. But God, most of all in this moment, we have to trust you. Father, you gave such a great gift to this family, to this church. Father, her testimony of life, love, and faith spread from Jamaica all the way to the United States. And whether they were here or made a stop in England, her love and her prayers to you were a guiding force. Father, I believe on today that she didn't just prepare them in prayer for the days that she was with them, but I believe, oh God, that she prayed prospective prayers for this family, even for their days without her. And so, Father, on today, we pray that every promise that you have made, we don't have to ask you to keep them, oh God, because you are a God that is a keeper of his promises. We thank you, oh God, that you are a God that all of your word to us is yes and amen to your divine will for us. And so, Father, on today, I pray that this family that is hurting, and Father, you understood that pain. This family whose hearts are broken, God, you understand that brokenness. But God, I pray on today that their hearts, although they may be bleeding, would know that you are near to the brokenhearted. I pray, oh God, on today that they would receive the greatest manifestation of knowing that you give the oil of joy for the spirit of heaviness. I pray on today, Lord God, that they would know that even in the midst of the confusion and chaos of our current world, that they would still know that you, oh God, give peace that passes all understanding. And we pray that it would guard their heart and mind. Father, we thank you for the seeds of faith, Lord God, that you gave to Mother Charrington, oh God, and she was not a wicked servant, oh God. She didn't put them in her pocket and walk around with it. She didn't hoard them to herself, but oh God, she spread them freely. God, because you said you give seed to the sower. And so, Father, even as was her practice, Lord God, in her youth of sowing seeds in the natural, Lord God, she took it, oh God, and she sowed seeds in the spirit. And God, it's because of that. We know to her children, to her grandchildren, to her great-grandchildren, and even to the generations that she will never see with her naked eye. But in the spirit, oh God, we believe that we, her church on this side, oh God, will reap a harvest if we continue to till and keep the harvest of prayer that you gave her to sow. God, we commit all of these things to you. And the strong, healing, delivering, comforting name of Jesus, we pray. And it is so. Amen. At this time, we will have a musical selection from Tanish Reed. Following that, we will have remarks from Eileen Young and Reverend Valerie Lewis. We're going to ask that as the remarks come, that you would speak from the microphone that is located to my right.
Let's praise the Lord. Let's praise the Lord. You guys kind of seem kind of silent. Let's praise the Lord. You know, mommy was a woman of praise based on what I'm seeing in the brochure. And so she would want you to be happy that she has gone home to be with her Lord. So let's praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm going to do what I was told was one of her favorite songs. I do hope. I must have the Savior with me, for I dare not walk alone. I must feel His presence near me and His arms around me thrown. Then my soul shall fear no ill. Let Him lead me where He will. I will go one murmur, and in His footsteps follow still. I must have the Savior with me, for my faith at best is weak. He can whisper words of comfort that no other voice can speak. Then my soul shall fear no ill. Let Him lead me where He will. I will go without one murmur, and in His footsteps follow still. I must have the Savior with me, and His eye the way must guide, till I reach the vale of Jordan, till I gain, she's gain the other side. Then my soul shall fear no ill. Let Him lead me where He will, and I will go without one murmur, and in His footsteps, I'll follow still.
But we do it out of love. Sometimes we may even have offended. And I know my auntie, she may have. But one thing I know for sure, she loved this family very much. She often talked about them. She talked about the grandchildren. I spoke to her regularly. We were on the phone, and we could spend hours on the phone. You know, when she started getting, when she was diagnosed back a few years ago with the neck issue, I don't like to call the name, but the neck issue, you know, she would call me up and she said, "I'm in so much pain. Pray with me. Ask the church to pray with me. My church is praying. I'm praying, but pray with me." And we'd spend hours on the phone. Family, I want to encourage all of you, stay in touch. Look around, look at yourselves. Look around. How many of you are here? The grandchildren, the great-grandchildren, look around. Uncle Sam is here. Auntie Dee is here. Uncle Bernie is here. Auntie Aileen is here, okay? You want to look for the elders? Reach out. If you're hurting, reach out. I'm here. So, mom is gone, grandma is gone, but you're not alone. You are not alone. If you don't have my number, get it from uncle and auntie. Call me if you must. I am here. My daughter, my grandson, they're here with me today. They're people from the church that I go to, Healing and Deliverance Ministries in Plainfield. We are here for you. Please, feel free to call us. She loves you. God loves you most. If you're here this morning and you have not yet given your life to Christ, don't let this be the last time you sit in a sanctuary. And the next time you sit in a sanctuary, it's to have the pastor standing over your casket. Okay? So remember, this morning I encourage you, if you are not, if you have not yet given your life to the Lord, please do so. That would have been the hope that Mother Charrington has for each and everyone. God bless you all.
Reverend Valerie Lewis here. If not, we will continue with the family tributes. And so at this time, we will have Israel and Trinity Cole, Andre, oh, Courtney first. Okay, Courtney's dancing first. Okay, amen. Okay. Courtney Charrington will come with her presentation first. And then following that, we'll have Israel and Trinity Cole, Andre Cole, Dolores Cole, Courtney Charrington will come back and speak, and then a tribute from her son, Samuel Charrington.
Can you imagine just standing before the King? I can only imagine what it would be like when I'm by your side. I can only imagine what I'm
Hallelujah. Come on, can we just take a moment and praise God right there? Hallelujah. Come on, let's take a moment and praise God right there. Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, how many people can only imagine on today? Come on, can you imagine what Mother Charrington is seeing right now?
Hallelujah. Come on, bowing and kneeling, amen, in the presence of our God. How many people can only imagine the peace? Hallelujah. I know they said she had a short illness, but how many people can imagine the healing? Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. I can only imagine. Come on, let's thank God for the strength of that granddaughter. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Woo. Amen. 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 Again, at this time, we will continue on with our family tributes. Amen. Amen. Bless your name, Father. We're going to ask Israel and Trinity Cole, Andre Cole, Courtney, and if you guys would come to my right over here. Yes, ma'am, to the red microphone here. Amen. Then Dolores Cole, and then our very own Deacon Samuel Charrington. Amen.
A grandma is a blessing. She's thoughtfulness and love, the finest and most precious gift, sent from our Father above. You know she'll always be there, whether skies be blue or gray. She'll always lend a helping hand. She'll never turn away. Each selfless thing about her is a special to recall. Grandma is a blessing, the most precious one of all. Love any name or name here.
I don't have a poem, my bad. Hello, my name is Trinity. As most of you know, I'm one of Grandma's great-granddaughters. She and I really never talked much, but we would always used to go to her apartment and sleep over or help her get stuff out. Whenever we did, she would always mention the Lord and talk about how you should follow in the path of righteousness. She would also ask if we were being good at home. We would always say yes, even though we were never good. She was a kind-hearted woman, but stubborn. My aunt Debbie Ann, she would always say that we were alike, but because we were both stubborn and hard-headed. I remember this one time when Israel and I were misbehaving and Grandpa took a belt and tried to beat us, but we hid under the table, knowing good and well he could not reach us. Grandma was just in the background saying, beat them now. But we were smart, so we stayed there until they calmed down. The point I'm trying to get to is that we all love and miss you, and we know you're in heaven at peace with the Lord. And we all are looking forward to meeting you again. I know this is a time of mourning, but the Lord said not to let this be a house of mourning, but a house of rejoicement.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Dr. Andre Doroni Cole. I'm son of Clinton and Dolores, grandson to our dearly beloved Ulysses Sherrington. I'll be giving a tribute on behalf of my siblings, Mark and Debbie Ann. Even though today it feels okay to be a little bit sad, we're celebrating the legacy of an amazing woman. We lost someone who was special and dear to us, to Harris, a wife, God rest his soul, to Bernardo, Samuel, and Dolores, a mother, to others, a sister, to others, an aunt, a cousin, a grandmother, great-grand, and a great-great-grandmother, and to so many, a friend. Most people come into this world and leave it the same way that they found it, but the people they leave behind are not the same, as they are not forgotten by their families, friends, and loved ones. Some of these people, some very special people, are not forgotten even by those who hardly knew them. Our grandmother was one of these very special people. She left behind many great branches and a harvest full of great fruit. What made her so special? Why is she remembered not only by friends and family, but even casual acquaintances? Very simply, because she was the essence of love, caring, and kindness. More than that, I think she was the essence of what I think of God's love. Just as her heart was not empty, neither were her words. She did not speak of compassion, she acted with it. She was dedicated to her family and to God. A woman of faith, not only evident by what she said, but also by what she did. how she lived her everyday life, treating everyone she met as family, even adopting others into her family. You will never find a soul as kind as hers. Though she may be gone in body, her spirit is still with us. It remains in our memories and stories we'll tell of her and the lessons she taught us, the lessons that she taught her children and their children, and that we will continue to teach for generations to come. She taught us how to be strong, how to be caring, and most importantly, she taught us how to love God. We feel so lucky and privileged to have known you, Grandma. She passed away relatively quickly, but she was able to be at home surrounded by loved ones, friends, and family. And as a family, let us be thankful and grateful for the good times that we have shared. One of the hymns that so vividly remind me of my grandmother is "When We All Get to Heaven." Sing of the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing of his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Grandma, I know you're singing and shouting the victory in heaven. And I know, and now I'd like to thank our great Heavenly Father for blessing us with such a great grandmother. With her kindness, caring, love. Grandmother, as you gaze down from heaven, we pray that your spirit is at peace and that our loving Heavenly Father would continue to protect and guide us upon our way as you did while you were here on earth. You are forever in our hearts. We love you, miss you, until the day we will no longer be apart. May her soul rest in peace. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. As the baby of Grandma, I want to say thank you for you all for being here. Okay. These past 2 years have been a lot for many, but to my family in particular, it meant a lot of grieving. Losing 3 grandparents in 2 years is rough. Especially as a believer, it's almost natural to tend to question God. God, why them? God, why another grandparent? But I'm also reminded by my favorite scripture, Romans 8:28, and we know that all things work together for them that love the Lord and who are called according to his purpose. And included in all those things are the bad things, the things that cause us pain, the things that have left our family, the things that left our family with an empty void. But I also look at it as the good things. My grandparents are no longer suffering. They are with God. They are at peace. Each death taught me something, but the biggest thing it taught me was to lean to God and not to my own understanding. So as a branch of a tree that was rooted in faith, I had to stick to my roots and trust God's plan in all of this. When thinking of my grandma, I think about one of the last conversations we had over this past summer. In this conversation, she expressed her gratitude towards my father and all the things that he sacrificed and did for her. She told me, in her exact words, "I didn't come to this country with much, but your father is something that I'm thankful for. I know my death is going to be hard on him because he does so much for me, even when I know he's tired. I know long after I'm gone, God is going to bless him for all that he's done for me as a son. Dad, take comfort in the fact that you're doing for Grandma never went unnoticed, nor did it go unappreciated. She loved you more than words could ever express." Lastly, December 21st was the last time I heard my grandmother's voice. When we received the call that she wasn't doing well, we naturally dropped everything in support of my dad and to go see my grandmother. As we walked into her room, she recognized me with a slight smile. Even as she was weak, she tried to say my name. Maybe it's because I'm her favorite, I don't really know, but I know I heard it. As we spent the time with her praying and singing, as we were getting ready to leave, as soon as everyone started to leave the room and saying their goodbyes, I lingered just to stay and get an extra hug in. As I was leaving, I made sure to tell her that I love her. And after multiple tries, due to her weakness, she tried to say, "I love you too." I remember saying to her, "All right, Grandma, we're leaving now, and we'll be back soon." Her eyes immediately opened as she was dozing off, and she looked at me and said, "Why are you leaving me so soon?" And I quickly replied, "No, we're not leaving you. We just want you to rest. I'll be back soon, I promise." Before I could walk away from her bedside, she said, "When?" From that day, I made it a habit to go see her at least multiple times during the weeks before she passed. "Grandma, I could ask you the same question. Why are you leaving us so soon?" "Because God knows I thought we had more time with you. But I thank you for the life lessons you've taught me, which made me into the woman that I am today. For that, I will forever be grateful. Rest well until we meet again."
Everyone, thank you all for coming to my mother's homegoing service. This is a tribute to my mom. I remember my mom in so many ways, but one special memory I have is during the time when I was sick, very sick. I remember having to spend time at the Oma, at her home, and she would pray for me. She would pray until she fell asleep. Sometimes the only sleep I could get is while she was praying. She would wake up in the middle of the night and she would say, "Dee, are you sleeping?" I would say, "No, Mom, I'm not." Then she would start praying again. She was a true prayer warrior. When my dad passed away, went home to be with the Lord on April 7, 2020, this was during the height of the pandemic. Hospitals, nursing homes, rehabs, everywhere were closed down. My dad was in rehab, and we could not get him out. Then we were told he had COVID. I was very sad because he died alone. No one could visit him or be there to hold his hand as he crossed over into eternity. I was very privileged to be at my mom's bedside, holding her hand as she crossed over into eternity. Sleep on, Mom. Sleep on and take your rest. We love you, but Jesus loves you best. No more pain, no more multiple myeloma, no scars in heaven. Rest in peace, Mom. I would like to use this opportunity to thank everyone for coming and to celebrate the life of my dear mom. I would like to dedicate this song as a tribute to my mom. No scars in heaven. Thank you.
Shall we bless the Lord? Shall we bless the Lord? Hallelujah is the highest praise. So shall we bless the Lord. Amen. Amen. The story is told of a couple who had lived a long life, but they always had difficulties. They were always fussing. So the husband died, and he went to heaven. When he got to the pearly gates, St. Peter said, the place is kind of full, so we'll have to have an interview for those to come in, and we'll have a spelling contest. So the word you have to spell is love. And he spelled it, and he said, you can come in. And then the wife died a few weeks later of a broken heart. And so she showed up at the pearly gates, and St. Peter was tired, so the husband was now manning the gate, and he says, we have to have a spelling contest. And she said, what word do I have to spell? And he said, Nebuchadnezzar. The preacher would say, you'll get that on the way home. And it speaks to unresolved conflict. Let me take a moment. I just couldn't find anything to write. It just wasn't coming. And I just lost for words, and I'm saying, Mom, I got to do this. But let me take a moment to thank a few people. I don't know if she's here, but there's a young lady, Darlene. I don't know if you're here, Darlene. If you're here, raise your hand. Darlene took care of Mom for many years, and she treated them as her mother and her father. In fact, she called her Mommy. And she wept so bitterly when Dad died, and when she heard Mom was really sick, I know it affected her. So, darling, from the family, I want to say to you, thank you so much. And may everything you poured into my mother's life be poured back into yours. I also want to thank the nursing homes, Complete Care at Summit Ridge, where Mom spent a few weeks, and also for the nurses and the caregivers. They were all shocked when they heard Mom's demise was so quickly, because Mom was, even though she was sick, she wasn't poorly. It's kind of funny. Those of you who are in this business know that when they perk up, they're looking towards home. To the doctors, Dr. Israel Grossman spent a lot of years. Mom was diagnosed with multiple myeloma some years ago, and that was a time of great worry because they wanted to have surgery like right away because the cancer was spreading. It had eaten out most of her neck, and they told us we had to go to New York, and we went to New York, and she can't take the journey to go to the surgery and the journey to go back every week was just too much for her, so we decided to do it in New Jersey. But in all of this, Mom never lost hope. I have never met a woman, anyone who prayed as much as Mom. She prayed in her sleep. You know, my sister kind of, that's her story, but my sister could not sleep for months. No sleep, not night nor day. The doctors didn't know what to do. And Mom took this grown woman home, kept her in her bed, and simply applied the medicine she knew best, prayer. She hugged her, she prayed her to bed, she prayed her until she was able to get back on her feet. Never seen a greater faith than what my mom had. And so that is what keeps me going, because I'm like a mess, but you probably won't know it. But she also had lymphedema. And so we decided not to have people spend money on flowers, but if you wanted to contribute to helping those who suffer from these two maladies, multiple myeloma and lymphedema, to make a contribution to It Takes a Village Without Borders. That's a nonprofit I formed. It Takes a Village Without Borders, itavwb@gmail.com. You can Zelle there, and we'll certainly use the funds to help those who are suffering, make awareness how to get tested, and point them to treatment. But as I know, we're pressed for time, so I won't be long. I thought what I would say in tribute to Mom is, how do you prepare for death? How do you prepare for dying? Because as Mom laid there, we talked a lot, because I slept there most nights, three times a week, four times a week. And so we had a lot of time to talk, and talk about serious stuff. You know, we joke around a lot, but we talked about serious stuff. And there was nobody more prepared for dying than this. So Mom would say to me, I'm ready to go home. And I said, Mom, stop it. And she would say, oh, you don't believe me, I think I'm joking. But I'm ready. When he calls me, I'll be ready, whenever that is. And her favorite hymn was always, thank you, Sister Tanash, for singing that hymn, because that was the hymn where I had to sing, and those of you who think I can't sing, I do sing to Mom. I must have the Savior with me, for I dare not walk alone. I must feel his presence near me and his arms around me thrown. That's the premise. The promise is, then my soul shall fear no ill. Let him lead me where he will, and I will go without a murmur. And Mom went without a murmur. She went peacefully. And for that, we give God thanks. So what are some of the lessons? I said, how do you prepare to die? A lot of people say, let's get insurance. Get buy a lot of insurance. But that is for the people who are left behind. They are the ones who are going to fight over the funds and so on. For yourself, what do? You buy assurance. The scripture says that when this building of this tabernacle is dissolved, we have a building, eternal in the heavens, not made by hands. The preacher is coming and he will tell you about this thing. But if you don't have that assurance, because there are only two ways we're going to leave this world. We're going to be leaving in a casket, or we're going to be around for the rapture. Some of us won't be around for the rapture, so we're going to be right out here lying in a casket and somebody making up stories or telling true stories. And so my encouragement to myself and to you is to buy that assurance. And Pastor will come and tell you more about that. But when he comes, he's coming for a church without spot and without wrinkle. And we have been wrinkled by so many things. And so Mama summoned us, all of us here, today for self-examination. This is not for her. All of this stuff is not for her. It's for us. This is the time, as you sit here and listen to these songs and these dances and the word, to have a self-reflection. Because nobody knows you but yourself. And if you're not sure, as Pastor would say, if you're not sure that you're sure that you're sure, speak to one of these clergy that's here. They may not be perfect, but when you're going down the street and the sign says this way to New York, you don't go and hug the signs. You follow the direction. So don't look at who is giving you direction. Look at the direction. Look at the way. And I'm serious, because that was what mom wanted. She was concerned about salvation. She was concerned about the souls of her grandchildren. I don't want to embarrass them, because she gave me them by name. And said, tell this one that, and tell that one that, so I'll have those private conversations with you. But I won't want to embarrass you in a setting like this. But that was all mom was worried about. She prayed for everyone by name. She prayed so long. I know sometimes you get teased about praying long, but mom prayed for everyone by name. If she didn't call your name, she didn't remember it. So that is what I wanted to say to you. I remember mom, my first memory of the first song mom taught me. And it was, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. And the next song she taught me, and that became my favorite song, I am so glad that the Father in heaven tell of his love in the book he has given. Wonderful things in the Bible is true, but this is the dearest. Jesus loves me. Jesus loves even me. Sinful, imperfect, stubborn, Mother James is here with the spirit of Jonah, but Jesus loves even me, even me, even me. So I'll never forget those things for that. Mom raised us in a way that you had to pay respect to your elders. And those of you who are not from the Caribbean would not know it. We had to refer to our older siblings by brother or sister. You couldn't just call them by their name. So it was brother this or brother that, and she was insisting that you would do that. Anyone that was older than you was your aunt or your uncle. So I remember those. I'll keep those things with me. I have to try to remember that, because you never really truly die if there's a memory. And it's the memory of my mom that would live on. I didn't think I would be able to stand here. But because of, I know what she meant and what she stood for, I have to try to live up to her expectation. It's not something that's talked about in church today. You're kind of seen as freaks, but mom was a believer in holiness. She had no time for stuff that wasn't holy. And she was a great discerner. You couldn't fool her. She would close her eyes, and when she opened her eyes, she would say something profound. She watched Christian television a lot, so when I go there, she would say, put it on Star or put it on the other one. And then, you know, she watched it all night because she didn't sleep well. And when certain preachers came on, she said, don't pay attention to that one. Because I don't know how you can preach and you're not quoting the Bible. So she was discerning that, where she like, no, I've never heard him preach from the Bible. It is always about money. So turn to another station, please. But the lasting tribute for mom is really her commitment to prayer and fasting. I never knew of a Monday when mom was not on fast. And we grew up in a small church in the country, and it was Church of God, sanctified. And they took sanctification to another level. No earring, no trousers, no perm here, you know, and so many other things that we take for granted these days that we're living in modern times. They were not living in modern times. They took it serious. But they would fast every Monday. And I know they're saying, time to get up, Pastor, need to preach. They would fast every Monday, and at noon, then they would start the prayer for the sick. and no matter how long the line was, they prayed for you one by one. Mom would rather pray than go to the doctor. I have to say, Mom, no, you have to go to the doctor too. You know, you have to exercise your faith, but also Jesus was in the temple with the doctor, so he did confirm doctor. But if Mom had a choice between going to the doctor and fasting and praying, she would do the latter. So that's a value that that I remember from her. And she believed in the reality of divine healing. She really felt that no matter what the doctor said, they didn't have the final say, because the great physician now is near. He's a sympathizing Jesus. He's the greatest name on mortal tongue, and the greatest carol ever sung. She believed in that. She had an unshakable faith. She didn't question why or why her. She just believed that if she was to trust God, and one preacher said, trust him when you can't trace him, because you're never alone. And that's what I got from my mother. And she believed in tithing. You know, when she got to the point where she couldn't write her checks, you know, she would order me around, please write my tithe. You know, this is my tithe, and this is for the scholarship, and this is for the food pantry. And when, in case she thought I forgot, did you write the check yet? And she would do that. So she believed that the work of the church had to be financed by the believers in the church. She really believed in that. And so many memories. I don't want to stay here and belabor you. I'm just, you know, I didn't choose to write anything. I just wanted to share a little bit of insight as to who my mother was. A woman who was steadfast, grounded in the word. In the early days when we were being trained here, there was a prayer room upstairs, wherever you remember it. And they would be praying on a Monday evening, and our training would start at 7:30. And they would pray so hard. They would pray so hard, we had to go to the prayer meeting and then leave the prayer meeting and go to training. And they would pray. The church, I think, closed at 8 o'clock. And they were there praying at night. And the sexton would go bang on the door and said, this is Jesus. You have to go home. You have to go home, mothers. You have to go home. You have to go home. You know, so those are the things I remember about Mom. And it's going to be tough. You know, when I hear that song, I must have the Savior with me. The tears will flow, but I'm going to remember that one day, it's not assured, you have to live right. You just don't see them again. Let's not fool ourselves. There's a premise, and there's a promise. We like to hang on to the promise without paying attention to the premise. There is a condition precedent if you want to see them again. And so I'll get out of the way, because there's a preacher coming, and he will talk to you about things eternal. But thank you so much for coming. May God bless you, and may heaven smile upon you.
Amen. Come on, let's thank God again for this son. Amen. And for all of the family who gave, amen, testimony of a life well lived. I believe that Jean and Ruth Gordon are not here. Okay, so we're going to move on to our acknowledgments, read by Deacon Brenda Thurman. Following that, the obituary from Bernardo Henry. And following that, we will have a musical selection from Tashane Wiles. And following that, we will have the eulogy from our emeritus pastor, Reverend Dwight D. Gill. Amen.
the Charrington family, I'd like to offer our sincere condolences on behalf of New Hope Baptist Church, our ministerial staff, our officers, our members, and friends, and let you know that if there's anything that we can do for you, not only today, but in the days and weeks to come, please do not hesitate to call on us. There are several cards. I'm going to pick about four of them to read for the sake of time. Wishing you comfort in the loss of your mother. The heart aches for what has loved and lost. Gently wrap yourself in the warm memories of your mother. Let the love that held you close continue to bring you strength and comfort with sympathy. Garfield and Marie and the Lemonius family, wishing you unlimited blessings and comforts at this time. Amen. My thoughts are with you. The Lord is ever near during this difficult time. Trust him to carry you through. He will never leave you nor forsake you. He will be with you always. May the Lord comfort you during this time of sorrow. From Sister Bridget, the Diva, and family. Goodbye is not forever. Love is. Deacon Charrington and family, thinking of you and wishing you peace now and in the days ahead. Love, Trustee Jeanette Parker. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Praying the Lord will comfort you with his peace, surround you with his love, and encourage you with his presence. Sincerely and fondly, Abigail Johnson. With prayers and heartfelt sympathy, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted, Matthew 5:4. Deacon Charrington and family, may God be your tender comfort in sorrow and bring peace and strength in the days to come, Phil and Alexis Garon. God is near in the loss of your mom, in every moment of every need, God is near. He sees and he cares, not a single heartbeat or heart cry escapes his notice. Deacon Charrington, may his infinite love and compassion give you peace to carry you through this time, praying for you. We love you and we know God sees you and hears you, hears your prayers. If you need anything, please let us know. Eric and Terry Majette. Remembering you in thought and prayer, Deacon Sam, Juliet, and family, let there be hope, let there be stories, let there be celebration of a life well lived. Let there be tears, let there be happy memories all of you shared. My sincere condolences, Deborah Rice. We have two resolutions. The Jamaica Organization of New Jersey, Success Through Synergy, January 14, 2023, to the family of the late Ulysses Teresa Charrington. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. Whereas words are inadequate to express our sympathy on the passing of your beloved Ulysses Teresa Charrington, know that we, the officers and members of the Jamaica Organization of New Jersey, share in your sorrow. Please accept our sincere and heartfelt sympathy as we join with you today in the celebration of her life. To God be the glory. And whereas God in his infinite wisdom has called from the labors of this life to the rewards of heaven the soul of your beloved Ulysses Teresa Charrington, a servant of God and a loving mother, grandmother, mother-in-law, family member, and friend, and whereas we look to God, the author and finisher of our faith, for comfort, knowing that he is too wise to err and too just to falter and is always by our side. Please know that our hearts and our prayers are with the family now and in the days ahead. for only God can continue to strengthen and sustain during this season. Be it resolved that we bow in humble submission to the will of Almighty God, and we commend the spirit of Eulistie Teresa Charrington to God, and commend you to God for comfort, strength, and peace, as God continues to comfort and heal you each and every day. And be it further resolved that this resolution is given to the family and a copy be placed in the files of the Jamaica Organization of New Jersey. The resolution is submitted by the order of the board and the entire membership of the Jamaica Organization of New Jersey. Resolution of respect from New Hope Baptist Church for Mother Eulistie Charrington. We are in a place in this world for a limited time, and with the breath of the infant begins the race to the grave, a race everyone must run. Whereas in the providence of God, he has brought to a close the life of Mother Eulistie Charrington, the officers and members of New Hope Baptist Church of East Orange feel that it is befitting to express their sympathy to the family during her passing. We commend you to him who knoweth best and will always do right. You have our sincere prayers. Be it resolved that we bow in humble submission to him who never makes a mistake, and remind the family to be encouraged by remembering this poem. When I must leave you for a little while, please do not grieve and shed wild tears and hug your sorrows to you through the years. But start out bravely with a gallant smile, and for my sake and in my name, live on and do all things the same. Feed not your loneliness on empty days, but fill each waking hour in useful ways. Reach out your hand in comfort and in cheer, and I in turn will comfort you and hold you near. And never, never be afraid to die, for I am waiting for you in the sky. The author is unknown. Be it resolved that a copy of this resolution be given to the family and a copy kept in the church archives. Humbly submitted, January 14, 2023, Reverend Thurcell C. Williams, Executive Pastor, Deacon Brenda Thurman, Chair.
A celebration of life. On June 9, 1932, a daughter named Elizabeth Teresa was born to the late Uriah and Zilla Johnson in Maley, St. Thomas, Jamaica, West Indies. After a brief illness, she was called home to her eternal glory on December 31, 2022, at the age of 90 years. She was surrounded by her loving family at the time of her passing. The third of four children, she received her education through the Jamaica public school system. Mommy, Grandma, Miss U, Aunt U, Slim, Buck, Sister Cherry, Mother Charrington are some of the names she was affectionately called. However, her favorite were Mommy and Grandma. She met and married her soulmate and the love of her life, Harris Charrington, in 1954. The union produced three children, Bernardo, Dolores, and Samuel. Mommy was the cornerstone of the family, or historian and the family matriarch. She additionally also often served as the unpaid in-house medical consultant who always had a cure whenever there were health challenges. Her suggested remedies range from a secret variation of rubbing, topical ointments, or some other concoction she devised. Her favorite cure-all, however, was a good cup of hot tea, as it would cure the gas, which is alleged to have caused the discomfort in the first place. A true servant of God, she accepted and served in various ministries in her home churches at Mango Road Church of God, St. Thomas, and the East Queen Street Baptist Church of Kingston, Jamaica. She migrated with her husband to the United States in the early 90s and settled in New Jersey, surrounded by her family. She became a member of the New Hope Baptist Church in 1995 and remained a member until her death. She was amongst the initial core group of prayer warriors of the Intercessory Prayer Ministry Group until stricken by ill health. She juggled multiple life skills and was adept at many. Her favorite were being a seamstress, farmer, and homemaker. She enjoyed cooking and entertaining the family. She had a resilient spirit and beat the odds in many different aspects of her life. She was strong yet gentle, focused yet balanced, driven yet practical. She had acquired strength and would often sacrifice her needs for the love of her family. To know her was to love her. She was a woman of grace and humility, making and remaining friends with her were effortless. The deep bond created would last a lifetime. She was welcoming, loving, kind, gentle, comforting, trustworthy, and loyal. Whether she just met you or if she knew you all her life, she would be there to lend a helping hand without hesitation. Among her many attributes were the fact that she did not let her circumstances dictate her faith, and so she remained fervent in her unwavering belief in the power of prayer. She embraced every day as a gift from God and consequently enjoyed life to its fullest and took pleasure in the simple things it had to offer. In our eyes, she was our angel, a touch of heaven to us. Mommy will be remembered for regularly fasting, praying, and interceding for the needs and on behalf of others, qualities that had her revered as a spiritual mother to many, both near and far. Her passing has left behind a great void in the lives of her children, Bernardo, Maureen, Dolores, Clinton, Samuel, Gillette, Marcella, Carl, Emmeline, grandchildren, Bernardo Jr., Brian, Mark Donnelly, Aisha, Andre, Debbie Ann, Adrian, Julian, Nicole, and Courtney. Great grandchildren, Kimberly, Sadie, Valentina, Ayana, Stephen, Adam, Christian, Israel, Matthew, Trinity, and Cameron. Great great grandchildren, Isabel, Harley Quinn, Callie, and a host of other family and friends. We salute you for your many good deeds. We will never forget you, Mommy. So sleep on and take your rest. We love you, yes, but Jesus loves you best. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I pray that just as she has gone on to be with the Lord, Sister Charrington, that we too will desire to one day see Jesus. I dreamed of a city called glory, so bright
so fair. When I entered the gates, I cried, holy. The angels all met me there. They carried me from mansion to mansion, and all the sights I saw. But I said, I want to see Jesus, the holy. I cried, holy. I clapped my hands and sang, glory, glory to the Son of God. As I entered the gates of that city, my loved ones, they all knew me well, and they took me down the streets of heaven. Such scenes were too many to tell. I saw Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac, talked with Mark and Timothy. But I said that I want to see Jesus, for he's the one who died for me. Oh, I bowed on my knees and cried, holy, holy, holy. We cried, holy, holy. My God is holy. I clapped my hands and sang, glory. I sang glory to the Son of God. Oh, I bowed on my knees and cried, holy, holy, holy. I cried, holy. holy. My God is holy. I clap my hands and sing glory. I clap my hands and sing glory. I clap my hands and sing glory. I sang glory to the Son of God. Yes, I sang glory to the Son of God.
Let the saints of God say amen. Amen. No, y'all didn't say that right. Let the saints of God say amen.
Amen.
Now say it like you love the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Hey, listen. Friends, Romans, New Hopians, Jamaicans, lend me your ears. I have not come to bury Sister Charrington. I've come to praise her. Can I tell you why I want to praise her? Because she loved God. And if you knew her, you know she loved God. Have I got somebody right now that would praise her because she loved God? Have I got somebody that would praise her because when everything else went wrong, she still trusted in God? Oh, I wish I had a witness in the house that could go from Psalms 46 that says, let not your heart be troubled. If you believe in God, believe also in me, that in my Father's house there are many mansions. Amen? Mother Charrington believed in many mansions. She loved God. Amen? They would get up in the morning. They would stay here late at night. They would sing some of the most boringest hymns you ever heard, but they are sitting in that room and they are worship God and have a great time. So somebody right now, if you don't mind, if nothing else, come on and worship God because she loved God. Come on and put your hands in the air and wave them like you just don't care because she loved God. Amen. Amen. Let the saints of God say amen. I'm almost done. I'm not going to be as long as Deacon Charrington was. Hey, listen. So, Deacon Charrington tells me a secret. And he tells me this secret because I have bought a house. And he says, my dad is a carpenter. And I said, awesome. I said, can I pay him to come fix up the house for me? He said, yeah. So, I said, all right. So I went and talked to him, and he had that heavy Jamaican accent. I didn't know what he was saying all the time. I just said, okay. And he would come over to 480 North Arlington. I would pick him up. And if I didn't pick him up, Sam would drop him off. And he would work all day long. And I would go in, and I said, Brother Charrington, don't you want lunch? No. My wife fixed lunch for me. I said, what? He said, yes, I'm going to eat the lunch he fixed. I'm going back to work. So about 3 days of that, I go over. I said, you sure you don't want me to take you back to the house for lunch? He says, no, Rev. Mommy made lunch for you, too. And I sat there, and we ate lunch together, the best sandwich I have had in a long time, by the way. But I want to say that because I want to praise her because she loved her family. No, y'all ain't say amen like you need to say amen. Some of y'all need to say amen, sure enough. Because even though you were unlovable, she still loved you. that even though you were not always good and weren't able to be put up with, she put up with you. And I need a saint in the house that thank God for a mother that loved you in spite of you. See there? Y'all acting like, I know we were perfect children. You weren't perfect children. You were not even close to it. But God loved you, and she loved you in spite of everything else. And wait, I came to praise her because she had your back. Come on, somebody say amen. She had your back when nobody else had your back. She lifted you up when nobody else lifted you up. She was there for you when nobody else was there for you. And you got the nerve to come here and mourn? What you mourning for? She was almost 90 years old, or was 90 years old. She gave you her best. And because she gave you her best, it was because God gave her his best. He died on Friday, got up on Sunday with all power in his hand. Man, let me your ears just for a minute. I didn't come to bury her. I come to tell her, you know what? You can get there, but you can't crown him until all of us get there. Amen? 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 No, amen. Do you know what amen means? Amen means so shall it be. Oh, mama died. Let me tell you something. Mama lived a good life. And she died a good death. Listen, this is what Paul said. He said it this way. I fought a good fight. I kept the faith. I finished the race. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of what? And y'all sitting there, what you weeping about? And let me tell you, keep your mask on. Don't take your mask off. But I just want to say this. Mother Charrington never wore a mask. She wore a physical one, but she never wore a spiritual one. You knew who she was, regardless of how you acted. That's why she fought a good fight. She finished the course. She kept the faith. I came to praise her because she loved God. I came to praise her because she loved her family. I came to praise her because she loved her grandchildren. I came to praise her because she taught me something that nobody else has ever taught me but my mother. And Sam said it like this: Jesus loves me. This I know. For the Bible tells me so. Little ones, to him, you are weak, but he is strong. And then she said, yes, Jesus loved me. Yes, Jesus loved me. Yes, Jesus loves me. For the Bible tells me so. Red. Yes, Mother Charrington. Just sing one verse of my song. Rev, if you're there when I go, just sing one verse. Mom, you know I'm going to do it. I'm going to be broken up, but I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it not because of mourning, but because I'm celebrating the fact that you held on. And you trusted God. Listen, this is it. I'm only human. I'm just a woman. Lord, help me to be all I can be and all that I am. Show me the stairway that I have to climb. But Lord, for my sake, help us to take one day at a time. Can I get a witness just for a minute that would raise their hand and say, one day at a sweet Jesus. That's all. That's all I'm asking. Yes. Lord, give me the strength to do everything that I. Yes. Yesterday is gone. Sweet Jesus. And tomorrow. Yeah. But Lord, for my help.
God for those celebratory words from our emeritus pastor. Come on, let's thank God for him again. Amen. Amen. We are now preparing to close the celebration of services for Mother Eulisty Charrington. We're going to ask all of those that will join us in going to the burial to line up in front of the church following the direction of our guards and funeral home. Put on your blinking lights as we prepare to go to the Hollywood Cemetery located at 1500 Stuyvesant Avenue in Union, New Jersey, after which we will return back to the church for a repast that has been prepared. Amen. Amen. All hearts and minds clear, if you all would stand with me. Father, we thank you for meeting us in this place on today. And we thank you for the life of your daughter. Father, we pray, Lord God, as we leave from this place, but never from your presence, that, Lord, they would continue to feel the comfort and healing of you. We pray in the strong name of Jesus, even now, Lord God, that although the snow is falling, that we will travel safely, Lord God, to the burial site, and that we would return here, O God, to the repast that has been prepared. Now unto you, O God, who is able to keep us from falling and to present us before your throne with exceeding joy, to you, the only wise God, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forevermore. Let all of God's people say amen.
for as much as it's pleased Almighty God to take from labor to reward this high village love sister, and therefore commit her body back to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, ensuring certain hope on that great resurrection day that she too will join with us, that the sea shall give up their dead, and in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, we should all be changed like a Reverend William. Normally, at Jamaica funerals, when we're in the graveyard in Jamaica, we sing a hymn before we leave. But it's too cold for a hymn today. Let us all be dismissed by the word, amen.
No grave can hold this body down. No grave can hold this body down. And the dead in Christ shall rise. No grave can hold his body down. I say no grave can hold his body down. I said no grave can hold his body down. When the trump of God shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise. No grave can hold his body down.
No, leave it. Come here.
I'm not going to let you in. Okay. I ain't going to let you down.
Thank you.
I will
my soul. Love is a land of peace and truth. It is all
the rest of my life. I made it up my mind. Jehovah, God's way the rest of my life. Goodbye.
Ladies and gentlemen, this now concludes our services for Sister Carrington. On behalf of the Woody Office Services, we hope that the service that we provided have been to the best of your satisfaction. And may God continue to bless each and every one of you. If we pass that, we're here to bring you back at the church. May God bless you.
Oh, Lord Jesus.